1 million of what you have in yourself. Okay, that then they have to compute. Yes? Okay, and the way you program this thing was with machine code. Machine codes are zeros and ones. And it had a word size of 16. And you would have one address, two address, and operation. And that's what we did. And it had also a board. And the board had the keys on it. And you would program it with the keys, or you have paper pen. And you would read the paper in machine code. And when you made a mistake, you put the paper tape there, put scotch tape on there, and there was a little block with holes, and you would make holes for the right thing. Fun, huh? And anyway, that in a few years changed, not too many years, and we got this thing called Fortran. It was a code that you actually had words in it, and it was much easier to use. And the people don't even remember Fortran, but Fortran, COBOL, the big languages that basically created computer. But it was a real mainframe. And you had to have a punch card or punch paper to go to. And this is a long story, but it's kind of put by some kind of show slides on this. And after you enter the data that way, you would have to actually enter data, you enter your program, and then you have to get some data in for the program to act on. And if the program was too big, you have to segment it in pieces and a little bit. And with passing of time, you know, this became more complex, better, and started having this idea of connecting to computer. And the main motivator to remote connection to computer, it wasn't very remote, it was my wire, was the idea of airline reservations, ideas of many people using the computer and take advantage that inside computer move very fast. And so they started doing this thing that they started at that time, they called time sharing, and it was really a computer with wires into it, and several people using it, getting the impression that they were the only user of this big computer. And at that time, the memories had gone from 8K to 8,000K or something like that. And so these things were kind of going that way. They had these terminals. And think about this, computer security of today, cyber security is the big issue today, correct? Now, what was the cyber security issue in a computer in a room with no wires? It was guarding the door with a machine gun and good walls around it. That was how you kept security. And then you identified who went in there, if you had any problems, you know who caused it. The moment you added the wires into it, you actually immediately created a security problem. Why? Because you didn't know who was accessing the computer, you gave them a password. And the password created its own security problems. Do you give the password to your girlfriend? Your password? Don't say yes. You shouldn't. Or maybe it doesn't have a girlfriend. So. You would?
No.
Bad idea. Don't give your password to anyone. Ever. Not even to your boss. And so there was this kind of remote connection, and progressively they developed a multi-block technology, which instead of putting a fixed wire to somewhere, you could go over telephone wires, and someone in the remote area connected. And at the same time, they could put two or three terminals connected to this wire. And why did they do that? Basically to make telecommunication costs less. But think about this, how clumsy this whole thing was. Meaning first, the box that you had to go to there, and you had to read little paper there, and that you had to read cards, etc. And then you put the wires around, and you have to be physically around there and connect. And then it kind of goes a little bit remotely, still these big, clunky machines. And that was kind of the paradigm of computing for a while. Things developed, but after that happened, progressively, they had this idea of creating smaller computers for hobbyists. And the hobbyist things like Commodores were developed, and they were not too big. And a lot of the large manufacturers said, who wants a little computer with absolutely no power? That little computer with absolutely no power had already 100 times more power than the original computer that I was describing. Okay? And some of the companies totally missed the boat. They had no idea that these smaller computers were going to be important. Actually, the head of IBM, Mr. Thomas Watson Jr., said, there is a market for five computers in the world. And then the guy who led Digital Equipment Corporation, a mid-sized computer manufacturer, said, who needs a computer in the home? So they had no idea, really, of what happened. And then this company called Apple came out with this, the Apple II, okay? And it was kind of a neat, nifty thing, and a lot of people were buying it. And they offered themselves for IBM. And IBM said, no, we're not interested in buying it. And you know the history from there. And after that, basically came this whole idea of better personal computers. First, the personal computer had a kind of letter interface whereby you would type in and you would get kind of command lines. You've seen command lines before. And then they had Apple came out with a Mac, and before the Mac, the Lisa, that was kind of graphic user interface whereby you could use a mouse and you could point to things and et cetera, making life much easier to the users of those things. And then people came up with this idea of a laptop. And the laptop was basically an Apple II or whatever, kind of compressed. And while we were coming with that, the computers were becoming more and more, these laptops were becoming more and more powerful, very interesting kind of devices. Okay, and then they created these many different types of these laptops. And progressively, what came after them? Same time tablets were emerging, cell phones were emerging, correct? And the cell phones were like what? Like dumb terminals, correct? Just made phone calls. And then progressively what happened? They put an operating system on a cell phone and they got what? The power of the computer in what we call smartphone today. Okay? And that's progressive evolving. And at the same time, what was happening? What did you say? Yes. Well, besides the cell phone development, what else was developed? Tablets, yes. And tablets came in many families of being. And what we have now, we have this whole domain of smartphones, tablets, laptops, large computers. And what is it? Why did some of you said, mumbled here, that smartphones replace computers? And why is that?
I mean, one of the more basic functions that people see from the smartphone computers.
Okay, they do a lot of basic functions. Actually, some of you, as someone was saying here, a smartphone is more powerful, has more applications than a computer, than a laptop. Didn't I hear someone say that? Isn't that true? Does a cell phone, a smartphone, have more applications? It's a trick. I'm asking a trick question. yeah, they are applicable to both, but do they have more, can they do more things?
Yeah.
It's a trick question. Is there more applications? Yes, because there are different brands of cell phones, and they have a huge, millions of applications being sold or distributed in the markets. And typically, laptops were not originally developed for apps. Okay, what they were developed is for big programs installed around their operating system, and so the variety is a little small, smaller. And however, it goes all over the map in both sides. But the reason why smartphones are more popular and there are more of them is a very simple one. They're cheaper. Okay, and so they're more ubiquitous, more common. Okay, so that was a necessary background once I realized. So this is the number here for you. 3.4 billion internet users. So 46% of the people have internet. Can you believe they are without internet? Like who? Your grandmother? Your grandfather?
No, I had a professor. After every final exam, he would go back to Greece and he would send us an email before we would go and he'd say, my parents' house does not have internet.
Oh, okay. Greece. Yeah. Yeah. My mom's house in Rio de Janeiro, she passed away. There's a lot of internet. And many networks competing. But yes, that's like places that people opted not to have internet. That's very little. What is the other reason why you don't have internet?
It's the infrastructure.
Huh?
The infrastructure.
There is no infrastructure, like you're in Africa someplace. Maybe less in South America and Africa, in some places, in remote Asia. What is the other reason? If your income per day is $1 a day, can you really afford it? Only one service. What is it? Government gives it. Many governments are doing that for them. Still, you need the device that costs. And there are these devices, the smartphones, are more expensive than the dumb phones. But the overall view is there are much more smartphones, devices, and there'll be much more than anything else. Now, the internet access became a smartphone game. Yes?
What's the penetration of in America?
I think he was kind of right. In the 80s, depending how you count it. Very high. Who doesn't have telephone, cell phones? My granddaughter is 3.5, and she begs me to watch the TV. And do you know what it means, watch TV? Is pick up this, mine, and she knows how to get into it. And I developed this very interest on Disney Junior. And I'm counting 1, 2, 3 and identifying letters. So she finds the app there and she goes, the 1.5-year-old still doesn't do telephones. Although he tries to throw my telephone across it. but yeah, children, very young children. Who else?
People in very rural areas.
Rural areas, illiterate people, and very old people. That can have physical difficulty to read them. And that's really, and everyone else wants it. Now the question is, can they get it? But this is a, look at how many smartphones exist. Okay? And this is the next type of thing. You know, through this month we are together, I'm going to be yelling at you every time you look at your cell phone. Why? Because I want you to learn to spend 1 hour, 2 hours, or 3 hours without looking at your cell phone. We'll give you a competitive advantage. And you go in an engagement in audit, you're playing your cell phone all the time, it's not going to be a good idea. Okay? And this is a very serious problem of attention span that we have developed in the latest 10 years or so. And we are going to talk about how our cell phones and computers affecting your brain. And you are going to see that the multitasking that we do today is a terrible enemy of your ability of logically thinking and bringing facts together. This course is going to be very different from your other courses. I don't ask you to memorize anything. My exam, end of the semester, is open book, open internet, close friends. Okay? And so you see a lot of different things in my method of education. I always ask, what do you need to remember in the age of Google? And I have visited the CPA folks, the people that give the CPA exam. We had that conversation. And what did the conversation tell? I said, why are you requiring people to memorize all these facts? And the half-life of the knowledge is about 2.5 years. So in 5 years, you're going to know all these complicated facts that Professor Semello will teach you in accounting, but you'll forget most of them because you'll never use them. Until you're a manager. She was a manager, isn't that true?
I was a senior associate.
So, did you need them? Okay, she was with PwC, and this is the fact. So I asked them this question. And they said, oh, it was very difficult to change things. And no one kind of said, no, you're saying stupid things. Okay, it's very difficult. They have this thing called NASMA. And NASMA is Association of State Boards of Accountants and a couple of others. That's 54 entities, so there must be a couple of others. And they determine what goes in the CPA exam. Tomorrow I'm going to, speak to NASMA in one of the conferences, in the hope that I can convince them eventually to make it a more rational form of exam that would be really beneficial. But the generic idea here, and they are changing the exam. The exam became a little bit more interpretative, a little bit less memorization. Actually, the exam just started now in 17, is a changed exam. But it's changing very slowly for this kind of modern age here. Okay, now look at the other things that she talks about here. This number 3 that I started talking about. Americans spend 5.6 hours a day engaged in digital media, 3.1 hours on mobile, 2.2 hours on laptop and desktops. Now, that's a lot of time spent. How much time do you guys spend on your cell phone or yourself, just give me all together. How many hours you think? You have no idea, correct? How many you think then and there?
Probably two.
You spend much more than that. I know you. So, have you thought about multiplied by 85 years that you expect to live, or 89 years that you expect to live? How many hours you're going to spend fiddling with the device? Is that good or that bad? I got a smile here, but she didn't say good or bad. What do you think?
It's bad for, it's bad for your health.
Bad for your health?
But you can't help it.
Okay, let's not do good and bad because that becomes very complicated. But I kind of left something hanging here that I wanted to talk to you about for a second. Is remember I was talking about this big computer connected and the cybersecurity danger. And what I basically was trying to tell you is something I always say, technology given, technology taken. Every time you get a new technology into something, you are getting some facilitation of doing something. It's good. But the moment that you put new technology in place, you are creating some hazards. You are creating some risks. And the two major risks are, can you tell me? Maybe three. Now that she brought your health into this, I forgot about that one.
cause a loss of job?
Okay, that's number four. That's a big bad. Oh, I think the two biggest risks are privacy, correct? And security. Yeah, those are the things that, you know, any additional set of information you get is a risk to privacy. Have you ever thought of the following? That's good. I'm going to put a new article into your folders. Have you ever thought what information about you is spread all over? Or someone has access to it? First question is, what does Google know about you? No, let's be specific. What do you think Google knows about you as primary source of information?
Google.
Am I supposed to hang out or say Kai?
So Google, I used to look at everything. They know where I've been to, they know my photos, they know who I emailed, and they know what I emailed, and they can actually mine my email, and they generate pre-written responses that I just click on.
Good, that's a very elaborate response. Good. Now, why does Google allow you to search for free?
They
want the data. They need the data. So that's Google. The easiest one to think about Google, you know, not everyone does what a Hangout does, which is put everything on Google. Okay, I try not to. Okay? But, very interesting, what you search is very valuable information for them. Why? They did a study and they compared the Center for Disease Control. What is the Center for Disease Control? It's this thing in Atlanta that gets reports from doctors of sicknesses that they diagnose and creates a map of contagion in the United States, what diseases are happening, and etc. And by looking at searches on Google, they could predict flu epidemics faster than the Center for Disease Control. Pretty impressive, right? Just think about other things that you review on Google. Embarrassing things, correct? If you're looking at girls in bikini on the internet, Google knows. Guys in bikini on the internet, same thing. They know. Okay, so the search information is very valuable for them, and it's very targeted because you know pretty much what's being searched there. Now, pictures. Is that revealing about pictures? Is pictures revealing? Yes.
Well, each picture comes with its own within the metadata location, where you took it, you have the image of the pixels or the picture itself.
Okay, he went ahead of what I wanted, but good. So, when you take a picture with a digital smart device, it tags, like HTML, it creates tags of location and identifies taken. So that's some information in there. But the technology is not yet at the stage of very easily identifying where the object is. But if you think, look at Facebook, or look at Picasa, face recognition is quite good, more excellent. Maybe like 95% actually these things, if there is a model for it. So, we are better at the voice technology than we are at recognition of images. Yeah. Now, besides Google, and I'll come back to Google a little bit, who else collects a lot of information about you?
Facebook.
If you use Facebook, yes. social media in general, correct? Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest. Okay, that's kind of one source. How about, have you talked about Amazon? About half of all purchases over the internet are made on Amazon. Also, Amazon have hundreds or maybe thousands, several thousand of stores that are piggybacked on Amazon. So you go skiing in Jackson Hole, Wyoming. The infrastructure of sales of Jackson Hole, Wyoming is based on Amazon. They sell their access and they sell their product. So someone has half of all the purchases that being done. Next thing, location. You always think about how do you think that your location is determined? GPS?
Metadata. This is metadata.
Yeah, but how is that established?
They attach a cookie to the
But they need, that doesn't have the location. What tells you location is either a capture of GPS information, but the most common way is what the technology that we have in our labs is called G. And it's basically triangulation from towers. Okay? Theoretically, it's not exactly that way. Cell phones are in an hexagon of towers of telephone. And by the strength of the signal, it identifies a little bit worse than GPS, your location. And there is another thing about location, more like country, is the IP number, the number of your internet access. Everyone has an IP number. And it is basically Rutgers has a bunch of IP numbers. And Essex Community College has a bunch of IP numbers. And that kind of give you a generic location and then you know the country and etc. But the best is GPS or G. But you know location, purchases, what do you search? And then he mentioned one more that is kind of somewhere in the middle, is what's in your emails. Why does Google give you free Gmail? How many of you use Gmail as your main account? Also, I use Rutgers as my main account, but I route my Gmails into it, my Yahoo mail into it, I route everything into it. So that's bad because now they know all my email addresses, correct? So what does this tell you? Remember the four threads. My two threads became four privacy. Okay, I say, forget about privacy, privacy is dead. But don't worry too much, you're not very interested. Okay, and I'll come back to this. Okay, meaning interpreting this data, putting it together, doing a lot of things that cost a lot of money. And so directing it to you has to have a reason. Although there are some apps that are generic. This is really Mellinica's interest, is advertising and economic, etc. $73 billion spent on digital advertising, $50 billion desktop and mobile. Global internet and spending, ad spending, set to drop TV spending this year, around $200 billion. No one expected it to happen this fast. Google, $35 billion in ad revenue. Facebook under 15 billion. Now, one thing about Google. Ad is the top revenue they have, but selling data is becoming a big item for them. And if you start thinking about the idea that they sell the data, you start understanding what kind of things privacy faces. At least I'm angry because none of this. Okay? I invested in heavily in FedEx and UPS. That was 15 years ago and I didn't do too good. Now they are growing at 10% together. Okay, very interesting, the story of online purchases. Took a long time for getting off of 1% of sales. But now it's kind of going exponentially. How many of you still go a lot to stores? None? I expected some females to raise their hand. Because in my household, the female goes to store a lot, and the male never goes to store. I don't think I've walked into a store except to avoid the heat, walking my dog to the air conditioning of Bloomingdale's. I live in the city. But I haven't been to a store for 20 years, 15 years, whatever. I'm planning to because all my clothes don't fit me very well. So I'm planning once to go to a store. But no, and not telling my personal habits, just to illustrate what I'm saying is the patterns of buying. She talks here about 10 billion packages sent a year. And you know, it's the economic model is really complicated. You guys at Amazon, what is the pricing of the pack of the shipping of packages? You spend $75 in 1 year and you buy Prime. And then it's free.
Free shipping.
Huh?
Free 2 day shipping. You have to pay for 1 day
shipping. For 1 day shipping or for the same day shipping in Manhattan. But you can get it free too. But what's very interesting is that suppose it's free for 2 days shipping. So what is the story behind that? Your increment, you can order one package, wait 2 hours, order another package, wait 3 hours, order another package. And they are all free. Okay, it's very interesting how they can sustain that. It's very interesting. I never really understood. They must have some special deal with FedEx, something you don't know. But it's very, very interesting. And also, have you understood that instead of you walking to the store is walking to you? And there is an economy of scale there. Because there's a guy with a truck with a lot of packages there, and he takes one out, takes the other one, there is a good sorting mechanism, there is tremendous supply chain associated with that. But is it a net change in behavior? How many of you buy food over the internet, not ordering from restaurants, it's deliveries from supermarkets? No one. Yeah, I don't do it either, but my son does. Okay, now how many of you have food delivered to your home? Like Seamless, something like that. Any order from a restaurant to home? Oh, okay, more hands are coming up. Okay, and this is actually a changing habit. More people are delivering restaurants to home, food from restaurants to home, more people. The grocery business has taken off very, very slow, but it's moving. It's moving. And this is a whole change in logistics. What are the effects of this? Let's suppose that 10% of the people stop going to groceries, let's say, except for fruits or something like that, perishable. What's the consequence of that? 10%. Over the internet, you know, when Amazon sends me offering a new machine learning book, I buy it before I realize I don't need it. Okay, but maybe, but then I think the biggest effect is 10% of less people are going to walk in. And what's the consequence of that?
Some stores will close.
You know, I didn't link to things. I walked my dog always in Manhattan. Okay? And I started noting that every block there was a store for rent. Or every other block. Sometimes very big things. And I said the economy is booming. The economy is the best it has been in the last 9 years. Okay? Why is this? Is Manhattan a local problem? And I said that I finally, and my wife immediately said that store owners are getting greedy, the owners, and charging too much money. Probably some too, but actually this is a big effect. And the other effect is supermarkets will not pick up the goods, take it to the supermarket, and from there people pick it up. They are going to have bigger warehouses in the boundaries of cities and do a much better supply chain on that. And there will be little robots picking the stuff up in the shelves. I will show you a video of them next class or something like that. Now, this is a comment. While at the same time Amazon is opening a physical bookstore, does that mean anything? I don't think so. I think they just want to brand. What do you think? No? So they want to become like Apple, with real distribution stores, real cool stores. I don't go buy clothes and accept, but I love to go to Apple store next month, just to look. Yeah. So they want to spy on you. Actually, there are technologies for that. You know, there are technologies that follow you in stores, look at your eye movement, okay? And they have technologies now where you have cash, right? You have your card, and you identify yourself, or you have your store card, which has a radio frequency chip, RFID chip, and while you're going, kids often knows that you buy a lot of diapers, so when you go diaper, you get a discount, etc. They have these kind of perfected technologies. And I actually don't understand exactly when everyone is going off, Amazon is building a brand. I think they think they're going to make money, either by getting information, or by having an Apple-like brand, or who knows what they're doing. But they can afford it. 400 billion of online retail sales in 2017, a sector that has been growing average of 15% a year since 2010. So, guys, look things in perspective. When did the World Wide Web, the WWW, if you recognize the name, was created? Who was a PhD student at Stanford, had created this website. Okay, so that's what I'm so the year was actually 91. But still thinking about this, 25 years ago was when the web started, basically. Okay, and look where we are now. Okay, now this is, these are his comments, and I just kind of go to them somewhat fast. Lots of slides on trends on gaming and sports. And Mika mentions education. And then the whole discussion of user experience. How many of you, you don't have to raise your arm if you don't have to. How many of you do online gaming today? No? Just a few? How about gaming on the internet or on a device by itself? Actually, that's less than I thought. I think much more people did game. How about subscriptions? How many of you have music subscriptions? If you have Prime, you have music subscription, right? Should I ask how many of you pirate music? No. Okay, Netflix has 9 to 8 million paid global subscribers, while capturing almost a third of all home entertainment revenues in the US. So Netflix is a big, big success. Who are the competitors of Netflix?
Amazon.
And who else?
HBO.
Think how you think about these things. My daughter sitting in Yosemite today, okay? And if you put her on the internet, Charlie, C-H-A-R, right? You have to learn how to spell Vassarelli. It's part of the exam, you know. Charlie Vassarelli, she was yesterday when Alex Hornpole climbed the El Capitan mountain. You know, El Capitan in Yosemite, mm-hmm. Highest mountain in Yosemite, has been climbed many times, but little difference. He climbed it without ropes. The most difficult route of El Capitan, or the most common route without ropes. So it's a big event, you will see. It was already newspapers. She stayed one more day to do interview in NBC and etc. Why is my daughter being interviewed when Alex climbed the mountain? It's because my daughter is married to a guy called Jimmy Chin. And Jimmy Chin is an Everest four-time very famous climber, but he's a photographer. And he has been hired by National Geographic to film this event. So he was hanging from a rope while he was climbing on the film. Okay, can you imagine? Nuts, these guys are total nuts. But can you imagine climbing El Capitan without a rope? Now what's very interesting about this is National Geographic. Everyone knows National Geographic, correct? They are trying to compete with Netflix. Why? Because they are doing original productions on the internet, going to do their own, or hire someone to do that distribution. Okay, and what is Netflix? My daughter did an episode on this Chrysler designer for Netflix last year. And so Netflix, that was, do you remember how Netflix started?
Yeah.
Does anyone remember you? I don't know if seen someone else remembers.
It's like DVD rented fiction.
Yes. Netflix was a technological play against Blockbuster. Does everyone remember Blockbuster?
No.
You don't remember Blockbuster? Blockbuster was a store all over the United States that you rented tapes.
Oh.
And so what was the Netflix gig?
DVDs.
Yes, you would, instead of going to the store and picking up, it was like I did it to my daughter many times, went to the store next to our house in Long Island, and then we kind of argued about what a Donald Duck or something I wanted to watch, and then we finished up getting both, of course. But that was the entertainment. You went, and kind of social event with your family, choosing the. And then Netflix had this idea that I could send by mail DVDs. And the worst thing about Blockbuster was the penalties if you are late to return. It cost a fortune. And so they kind of abolished that. You had a coupon of DVDs. Like you paid for three or paid for five. And you just kind of returned a couple, got a couple new ones. And you kept your list on the internet. And I still have Netflix DVD service, although I don't use it very much. Now, that was there, starting the market. But what happened with Netflix after that? Come on, guys, think a little bit. Yeah.
Well, I don't know exactly which landmark of it you want, but. They actually offered to sell to Blockbuster. Blockbuster said no.
Yeah, same thing as Apple tried to sell to IBM. IBM said no.
And then they set up their streaming service 2 years later, and that's taken off.
So what happened then is a new technology came in, streaming. Streaming by itself doesn't do anything. A lot of people have to have devices to stream. Correct? If you don't have how many billion cell phones they're talking about there, 2.6 or something like that. If you don't have a device, you can't stream to anything. What else do you need? You need software to stream it, and you need someone in the other side to sell it to you. Yes, no, maybe. So what we just did is devised the cyber value chain. Or sometimes you call it the ecosystem. The way information goes from the provider to a device to a person. And this is much more complex because there is a flow back of money, correct? There is a distribution network, etc., etc. But what happened with Netflix? Netflix realized that the market started to flatten up and maybe even go down. What did they realize? Yeah. That was one part of the thing, because they're paying a lot for content. And what was the other thing?
Well, Apple released the iPhone along with the App Store. And people started getting more comfortable doing stuff with their own personal device.
Yeah, you know what was the difference? Talking about comfortable. The first thing that was a big obstacle in any of these online sales was the idea of putting your credit card online. Okay, that was very delicate. And in Europe, took much longer than in the United States. And in other countries, still people are not comfortable to do credit card over the internet. So what do? They create prepaid plans. They create little stores that you go in there and pay for your things in India. There's all kind of varieties of model. But what happened here is that this idea of physically mailing the DVDs started obsolete because devices proliferated. Other thing is bandwidth proliferated. Bandwidth became wider. Bandwidth is like a tube of data that you can get. If it's very tiny, it takes hours to download the DVD. if it's fat, you can download it very fast. And you have to have a live software. But the moment, and what basically happened, Blockbuster went bust, meaning they basically lost market share and they didn't discover how to change. And Hulu and etc. they've taken Netflix if Netflix hasn't moved in that direction. And that happened what Isabel is saying here, is that these guys is kind of, well, you know, there is this, people make a lot of money producing movies. So we are going to produce movies too. And the other thing that Netflix was desperately doing at that time was getting contracts with people that produce movies. Contract became very, very important. But what's the most incredible story behind this is how Netflix managed to change their model from a very successful model. They didn't sit on their model. And this is what we talk about change and the difficulty of dealing with a successful model. There is a professor from Harvard, a guy called Christensen, that talks about, the book is called The Innovator Dilemma. And he talked about what happens when a company that's very successful is faced by a technology that it will totally change their business. And we already had several examples here. Apple tried to sell itself to IBM. IBM didn't buy it. Okay? It goes on and on with the stories of dynamically changing the type of technology that comes in, and the dominant company cannot be. I was at the AT&T at that time, Bell Laboratories. Bell Laboratories was at that time, or during that time, the most successful, the largest research center in the world. When I joined Bell Labs in 85 in Columbia, Bell Labs had around 20,000 employees, of which 8,000 were PhDs in the physical science in general, and they had a budget of $4 billion. So this company developed everything that you use in telephony, maybe not the current version, but an older version. And turned out they finished up without a cell phone company, without a mobile company. And meaning they had developed the technology. The first cell phones were, or something like a cell phone, where it was in the lab. We tried things like different types of equipment and things that I was working on in the lab. And we finished up without one. Because this disruptive technology, as opposed to sustainable technology, was just going to change the business model dramatically. What did they do to resolve this problem? Eventually, they went out and paid a fortune for a mobile company and called it AT&T Wireless. But they just couldn't pick the company up. So this kind of story, the disruptive technology story, is very serious. And I have a reason to introduce it here. And the reason is, I think auditing is starting to go through disruptive change. Don't look so sad. You are still on the safe side of what this disruptive change. They're still hiring. They're hiring more now than they hired in the past. Okay, but I was speaking at the PCOB, that's a public company, accounting oversight board. And this is the organization created by Sarbanes-Oxley to regulate and inspect CPA firms. And they were all talking about disruption. The four people from the firms, and board members, and etc. And we are going to come back and talk about what's changing. But I already introduced it a little bit. Technology is changing, and the data that's available is changing. And the business model is changing. The firms are making much more money from consulting than from auditing. And so there is a lot of thought being placed on how do you create this oversight function, keep this oversight function honest with integrity, doing the verification function that it needs. And when I was talking about XBRL here and then I talked about assurance, I was already starting to address this kind of revolution that hasn't happened very well in accounting yet, and certainly hasn't happened in auditing. So this is where we are going. So stay with this and remember these words, disruptive, technology, and actually efficiency and cost to state. And the thesis by Christensen is that, and I think the title of Innovator Dilemma used to be Innovator Dilemma, why big successes company fail. And this is the story, the most classic story is, have you ever heard of Western Union? You guys must have heard, Western Union is a leading transfer money to foreign countries. But Western Union used to be the largest telecommunication company in the world. Turn of the century, of the last century. And the telecommunication they did was in telephone calls, was telegraph. Have you ever heard of telegraph? Telegraph, you kind of wrote the text and they broke it down and they sent little messages to all around the world. My uncle was an expert on sending telegrams. He lived in Brazil. And he abbreviated the words and joined the words in a way he charged by word. Okay. Except that no one on the other side understood what he did. But he was very good at creating cheap telegrams. Okay, but Western Union was a very large telecommunication company. And then this guy, Alexander Graham Bell, comes up with this invention, which was the telephone. Okay? And he went, same kind of story, went to Western Union and said, you want to buy my patent, you want to help me? And they said, nah, who is going to use this thing? And Western Union is gone. And Alexander Graham Bell created around this technology. There were hundreds, maybe thousands of companies created. And then the US government decided that it was better to allow a monopoly as opposed to all the little companies that they talked to. So AT&T came in. And it's a whole different story, which we're going to talk a little bit about later. But remember the story of disruptive technology, technology that changes things very much, as opposed to sustaining technologies, which is a technology that marginally improves what they do. So this is Netflix, okay? Okay, today about 4 in 10, $37 spending global IT infrastructure goes to cloud spending from 2 in $10 in 2008. What is this idea of cloud infrastructure? Let me ask someone that is not so technical to get the interpretation. Yeah, sorry, Samantha.
Because it's stored on your device, it stores it up in there.
Okay, and what is up in there?
I guess the on there, like, whatever company it is, in there appears.
Okay, right.
So instead of having each company having their own data center, they outsource it to like a third party. And everything is in like this large centralized data center, right? And like organizations like the Central Intelligence Agency, they have a few servers and Amazon, and so Amazon maintains like
okay, that's a good story actually. Just imagine something the size of this building. But not only one floor, all the floors, like a 5 football field size, full of computers. And it's not big computers, it's basically boards. And there are these racks, which are these shelves, board by board by board by board, and wires in between them going to the racks. So maybe 10,000 to 500,000 ports. And there are tubes coming in of telecommunication. And that telecommunication doesn't go directly to the ports, go to operating system, which is software, that basically allocates the communication to one of those little boards. All the time, a couple of boards are broken, people replace. But at that time, that operating system passes to the other ones. And very often, there are two or three of the boards replicating the process for one reason or the other. Typically, what they use is a thing called Hadoop, which is an operating system on top of it. But these are huge computers. Typically, they're located in cold places, because probably the largest operational expense that they have is air conditioning. So Alaska is a good place for it. Siberia is a good place for it. Okay? I haven't heard anyone in the South Pole, but I would imagine that for someday, maybe South Pole would be good. Okay? But you need two things. You need coal, you also need telecommunication in there, and power, I guess, three. So these big stations of computers, and people sell. Amazon has a very large servicing in the cloud, but IBM is competing, Apple is competing, everyone's competing on this domain. And how do you put data there? To either wire telecommunication or to wireless interwire that gets there. And how do you think about that? Is that borrowing a big computer in the sky? And that's the way you describe it, actually. And that's really a good way to think about it. But it's more, I just want you to now think a little bit out of the box and think, how is this changing our life and our world, having these huge computing centers sitting around in different places that you have no idea where they are, you don't have to know. And how are they changing your life? What's affecting you on this whole thing? Okay, let me go with someone.
If you ask that, is there a person who needs to bring up laptop or USB? We can just like, if we have the internet, we can like ascend the data like everything.
But you're thinking yourself. You need something, correct? maybe you want to invent a little CPU board you put here. With inside. Is that gross? Have you seen them? There are films that have that, correct? Yeah. And have you think about the USB board that you kind of stick in your head? I'm kidding, but I'm not kidding. Okay? So it gives you ubiquity, meaning you can be anywhere. And what is the big limiting factor? The board thing, I'm just kidding. The limiting factor is the communication ability between the device and the cloud. And typically, it doesn't go from the device to the cloud, the device to some to AT&T, AT&T to the cloud. Okay, that is this communication. But what else is it changing? So ubiquity is very important. What else? I'm holding on you. I want other people to think. Okay.
So the communication between devices. I have my computer, my cell phone, my tablet are connected to my account.
Yeah, that's actually a very recent development. You know, you think this thing so for granted, my granddaughter takes it for granted, that you forget that this is a very new thing. Having a Dropbox that every device you have the same data. You don't know how many hours I spend synchronizing my devices in the old days and making sure I have backups and everything. So that's a very interesting thing. Similar content. What else?
In the form. Recently, 3 years ago, a guy who worked for Google created a cell phone that's all cloud-based, and that then has storage in the form, which is a system server that you just go back and forth. We tried to sell it back to Google, right,
but they didn't buy it. What is the problem with this device with not with their own, with the lack of their own memory? Huh? Yeah.
Privacy is a really big issue.
It's sitting over there. If that thing doesn't have privacy, you don't have privacy. The second thing is you depend on telecommunication. You are in the subway, maybe it's not very good. Well, we did web goes. When class finished and everyone turns on, it's not very good. Yeah?
Well, that's what I was saying. It makes storage cheaper, and so it's more economically feasible to build bigger and bigger data centers to put big data. That's why big data is such a cheaper now because of the cheap availability of storage. Like 20, 30 years ago, computers used to make it like gigabytes, now it's a terabyte, extra bytes.
Yeah, I think that's a chicken and an egg story. It's not only about storage becoming cheaper, it's also my demand for storage becoming bigger. And I don't know which one that I choose, but you're right. But this is the kind of thinking you need to do. Go ahead.
From the business aspect of it, it allows companies to scale much more rapidly and make themselves more
agile. Okay, I want this as a very good point I want you to, meaning we start talking here, I keep repeating, so we kind of, you know, say that again, what you just said.
It allows companies to be more agile with their storage. So let's say they bring on a large account, they don't have to worry about buying racks and racks.
That's a very big change in the business model. Because, and this is what they call the Silicon Valley model, and which is the idea that instead of you having to invest $10 million in a computer facility and then start using it, you pay incrementally by usage. Probably if you would use up one-third of your $10 million facility would be more expensive than the incremental use. But if you use the $10 million, it would be cheaper. But that's what really made startups so easy to do is the fact that most computer services are incrementally priced these days. Okay, you guys haven't taken managerial time yet. But there is this classic model, fixed cost and variable cost. Fixed cost is what your setup cost is, and then for every new unit that manufactured, there is a straight line here that per unit it becomes cheaper because it keeps some of the base cost. And actually what this model, the Silicon Valley model, did is eliminated the fixed cost. Because it's bought by Amazon or whoever is providing it, spend the money, and then it's selling you little bits. Makes your life much easier. If you're a very big guy, maybe it's cheaper for you to do it yourself. Okay, stay with us, thoughts, we're going to continue. Okay, so this is the infrastructure story. Oh, okay, I want to say, make another point here that they don't make. Is this like a tentative? Where did we start with that? Fat computer in a room like this, costing a fortune, with no access. Then this computer kind of went a little bit smaller, went transistor, went integrated circuits, and then we started putting wires to it, and then we took the wires out, and then we did wireless into it, but still a big computer. And then Mr. Jobs came in, and some other guys came in, Mr. Gates, of course, and you went for this big computing devices for companies to have in these PCs, and the PCs basically replaced the dumb terminals that connected to the computers. So we went from a centralized computing to a timeshare centralized computer to wireless devices connected to computing, and then these wireless devices became pretty autonomous and do a lot of things by itself. And look what's happening now. We're going back to this big computer in the sky, and your laptop and your cell phone is not doing as much as did before. Okay, I want you to think a little bit more and tell me a couple of things that could not be done without very large computers somewhere to be accessed. And I'm not going to ask you because I want other people to think about it. I know you know the answer. Okay.
Video streaming, Netflix.
Oh, you already went too far. What is the biggest databases about you too that you can query if you want to find any type of information? Google. You think you could do Google in your laptop? Google has billions of engines, correct? And you say, Google, tell me the girlfriend of Peter Falk. Google will probably know the answer. We'll even know who Peter Falk is. Well, a few of you might know. Yes. Still remember him.
Okay.
So Google actually has this very, very large farm of information sitting around. And of course, everyone trying to copy Google has a tool. Okay, everyone is building, but Google is better because they have more people searching it. So there is more examples to be harvested and more questions to be organized and extracted. Okay, I want you to think a little bit. This is not directly here, but I want you to think a little bit. How do you think that this Google thing works? Come on, put your brains into it.
Yeah.
Basically, a supercomputer goes through and looks for tags and code relevant to your search query.
Okay, you're getting very complex. But how did they start? Well, how did they start?
So Larry Page and Sergey Brin, they were PhD students at Stanford University, and they came up with this algorithm called PageMap, and they were like ranking web pages.
Okay, let's start even before that. The problem is a web search problem. What was happening there is you wanted to develop a way to find things on the web. The web was growing very fast, and it was difficult to find something unless you told me what your address was. I didn't know how to get it. At least you wanted to find things that wasn't the case. So there were things like AltaVista and Yahoo that were search engines. And Yahoo was actually had a person organizing by talking. And then AltaVista had like a search algorithm, and there were several of these things out there. And then happened that these guys developed an algorithm that basically how frequently things were being looked for was important to be on a stack of information that you're looking for. And then they developed little robots, we call them crawlers, that went and this is connected to that. So we have that address and we have this address. And then you have this address and you keep collecting. And then many and many of these crawlers went around the world looking for connections. And they went back to this thing and see if there was a new connection. The moment Hangout wrote another link, that link would go on that thing. So this was kind of the big tree getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. But what it had there was just a little URL, a little address. But they were smart and they realized that putting a little bit more of the content there was a good idea. And then they realized that they could charge people for putting their content on top of other people. And then they said, well, we'll set up some algorithms. Remember this word, algorithm? They set up some algorithms whereby I don't need to price these things manually, but depending on the conditions, it creates a price for putting yourself on the top. So they sell dynamically those price things on the internet search thing. In the first 1, 2, or 3 is what everyone tends to click, unless you are cheap like me and try to find something cheaper in those things. And then they discovered that organizing that thing reasonably well could give them some information that they didn't have before. And you know, these things on the internet, you don't think everything in advance. You keep developing and you keep thinking about new problems here. They have a lot of smart people working, and they keep developing new things that they wanted to do with us. And that's actually the way these things developed. Now, these databases, they have all, let's say, what's the life of Peter Falk, or who was the person who first came to America, or who was whatever question you have. How do you think they do that? I'm not interested in the answer, I'm interested about you thinking about how they do it, individually. Someone already taught it. Original ideas is not an idea that no one else has taught. The original idea is an idea that you have, and you don't know that someone else has. And if you do enough of those, you'll have one of yours that is totally original. And they are typically associations. But how do you think that they do these things? How do you think that they kind of have all these interesting questions you can ask? All of you, I guarantee you that you pick up your phone or yourself and try to remember something, go there and ask the question to Google. And you sit down with your girlfriend in a restaurant, and very soon both of you are finding things on the internet that part of the discussion. Or just communicate them. And how do they do this thing of creating answers to questions on the internet? What's the easiest way to do it?
Different is that from Google, from
Google Home to Google. How different they are?
I imagine it's not that different.
Good point. So the baseline is voice understanding. And after you extract the content in text, it's basically the same problem as the other. Yes, no, maybe. Now, what's the problem of understanding voice? Might have a Hungarian Brazilian accent like me. And Alexa, when Alexa answers me, say yes, they close, and my granddaughter gets furious. How come I talk to Alexa and Alexa respond yes, they close? Because dot or echo doesn't have different voices. Now they're actually going to different voices. Okay. So I told a whole series of link stories. Have you noticed that? I started from Google search. Then I went to Google questions. And then I talked a little bit about organizing knowledge. Okay? And then I said, well, how do we do voice? And voice is there in the beginning. So you are going to hear, you're going to have a few tweets here. You're going to hear Chao. That's our PhD student, Chao Li. And Chao will be talking about her cognitive computing dissertation. And what we are trying to do with that, hasn't been done as far as I know in the CPA firms, is have these Google questions be auditing questions on a very narrow domain, breaking down the part of the audit, which we call the brainstorm part of the audit, where you look at the basics. But the basic concept of organizing the knowledge, capturing the knowledge, is going to be cumulative. So Chao is thinking about KPMG having 1,000 partners that they have, 1,200 partners that they have, all using this planner. And the more they use the planner, more the planner knows what to respond. And there'll be some guys down in Atlanta or in New York City, actually Montville in New Jersey, that the questions they don't know how to answer, we'll research and we can answer the official KPMG answer. This is called the restricted domain knowledge base. Restricted domain. Now let's go back to talk about Google a little bit. Is it interesting or isn't it interesting? It's very interesting. By the way, 10 years from now, this is not going to be novel. It's going to be very, very simple, current type of thing. I don't know if auditing will get there, they're very slow. But, you know, I'm sure Google and Apple and Microsoft are going to come up with products of very narrow domain, knowledge organization. And where does that leave you guys? Will you not have a job? You guys don't have a problem because you are going to be in the market soon. How about people 10 years from the future, in the future? There will be a different knowledge skill, I think. I think that still there will be many jobs for verifiers, assurance. Okay. Amazon. It's called Amazon Web Services, captured 57% of the public cloud market, followed by Microsoft 34%, Google 15%, IBM 8%. Does that surprise you? You thought Amazon made money by selling books? You know, Amazon is a very interesting company if you want to look at the business side of them. They are one of the few companies that are very oriented towards long term as opposed to short term. And so they don't care if a particular business of them is making very little money. Actually, the Amazon store lost money for the first 15 years or something like that. But people keep buying Amazon stock. Why? capture market share. They were growing, and the more people touch your application, the more money eventually they can make. And they were right. So this is Mary Meeker's prize slide, in my opinion. The enterprise IT trends from 2000 to 2017. We already discussed from on-premise to cloud-based. Pricing, subscription, and perpetual license. But the thing that she doesn't talk about there is the idea of incremental costing as opposed to fixed and variable costing. User interface, generic or personalized. Intelligence, what does that mean? Constrained or unlimited. Yes?
Is that in reference to like business intelligence and big data?
I don't think exactly. It has to do with what we're talking about, knowledge base. Either you constrain it into being very good at a few questions, or you do a la Google, whereby you keep adding questions, adding questions, and sometimes very good, sometimes so-so. Okay? I actually don't understand very well what growth engine means here. Does anyone know what it is? We'll check it out. Purchase decision top down to bottom up is basically companies don't decide anything what you buy. You decide as an employee what you buy. Okay, this is something also not terribly interesting. What is a designer and what is a developer? A developer is someone that puts code together. A designer is someone that makes things quick or creates interfaces. And what basically they are saying is that the designer to developer in 2010 was 1 to 11, so there was one designer to 11 people, and now there is one designer to 8 developers. Okay, so what does it mean? Software became better to help developers or whatever. Okay, let's go international a little bit. China. There are 700 mobile internet users in China. In 2016, $40 billion was spent on online advertising, up from $10 billion in 2012. Now, what do you think about the markets in China, and what do you think that happened with our big companies like Google in China? To be the leaders in your own country and sell well in the other ones. But if you do too much of that, what happens? The other country says, no, you can't come into our country. Yes or no? Okay, so that's, and of course, Google is not very big in China. And China has another complication, which is the big firewall in China, which is they basically control a lot of communication in and out of the country, but they also control a lot of communication inside the country. I went to visit my son. My son was spending, this is the early days of the internet, in Beijing, in a good university in Beijing. And he wanted to get rid of me. Okay, because he has to sleep with us. Okay, so he sat in the phone on a computer, and he said this keyboard has characters, you don't want to know who is this. I don't know how I can type without looking at the characters if you put me on an American keyboard. And then I said, but I can't go get out because the title was no problem. I don't know what he did, but I was doing Google, I was doing everything, etc. So there are ways around the big firewall, but it's a very, very controlled environment. And of course, an additional difficulty that it is no character language, correct? Which, of course, for Chinese is not that big. My wife is Chinese, so I'm used to this. I only know the words that help insult the husband of Chinese.
I shouldn't say this in front of the baby. She will see it and give me hell.
Andrea is laughing, but she left her. Okay, now, this is actually a very big thing in the internet. You see what has happened recently in the internet, that the sales of computer devices flattened out. The sales of internet-related devices flattened out. Why? Because people have it already. And it's expensive. But what actually a big market, low market, is India. Because India hasn't matured into the market. So there are 355 million Indian internet users. What's the population of India, by the way? It's similar to China.
Okay. A little bit
smaller. But look at how many users there are in China and how many users are in China, 700 million, in India, 355 million. Okay? And this is the other revealing thing, 80% of all web traffic in India is for mobile. And the global average for that is 50%. What does it mean? That the other devices are not so popular in India or too expensive. Okay, just a couple more things. And then I'll be a little bit. Okay? I know this is heavy thinking here, if you're paying attention. So, 87% of US office-based physicians use electronic healthcare records, up from 21% in 2004. 95% of hospitals offer patient digital care across their healthcare information, up to 24%. Okay, so what's happening in healthcare? This is like a big Obama thing. You can criticize Obamacare as much as you want, but in the whole Obamacare effort, he put a lot of money aside to create digitalization of medicine. So I think in New York State now, for you to get medicine and prescription, you can't get a paper prescription. The doctor has to basically email it to your pharmacy. Okay, that's the good side. The bad side is that technology is pedestrian that they're using, and they really should do much more. And in the US, you are full of similar tests. You go to one doctor, he gives you a blood test. 2 days later, you go to another doctor, he gives you a new blood test. Why? One is they don't talk to the other. The second one is doctors get some benefits out of giving you tests. There's a lot of things. It's very, very wasteful. The US is number one in spending per capita in population. So the US spends one-third more than Switzerland per capita. Even considering the US have about 20 million people, 50 million people that are uninsured today. Okay, and to make things worse, the US is 22nd in quality of medical care. So spends the most and are 22nd in quality. So what do you think of that? And this is motivation for Obamacare. And since then, I think things got a little bit better, but not much better. It's not the reason to eliminate Obamacare. It's a reason to improve. Okay. But this is the basic model of delegating to insurance companies. It's creating a lot of intermediaries. You know, countries like Canada, France, that are very high up in the quality of average care. These countries have basically no intermediaries. They basically pay directly to doctors, to service companies. is a MDMA learning socialized medicine. But in average, the clients, meaning the people, get better service, but they don't get all the services they need. You have to go to specialists for if you want to spend something that's not in the service. But what Obama did that was great is make this is give a lot of credit to Obama for this electronization of medical care and et cetera. And it's getting better. And I think that's going to have a big effect. Okay, this is actually very interesting to see how the US spends their money in technology. US federal budget in 2016 was about $3.85 trillion. Of that, 63% goes to entitlement and other health care, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid. 16% non-defense discretionary, 15% to defense, and 6% for servicing debt. So what does this tell you? Tell you that the government doesn't have a lot of control about what it spends. And entitlement spending accounts for about two-thirds of the spending. Two-thirds of the debt was about 19 billion. And by the way, the rule typically that International Financing Organization said if your debt is larger than your GNP, that's a problem. And but what do we understand here? And actually, if you look at some detail, the US doesn't have a lot of money to spend in technology and should be spending it. And what's really the problem is in the US infrastructure is the due. Overall, that's in general. Now, some very interesting things for you accountants or for you users of information is the Open Data Act, which basically says that federal organizations need to provide data on details of what they spend. And so City of Newark, Ohio, all kind of states are opening their data up. And you're going to take probably audit analytics in general February, March, and there you're going to use some of the data trying to do some analysis. A couple of our PhD students did a study. It's called, they call it the Armchair Audit Study. And the idea is that if you put all this government information, it's basically like the Ohio check is what Ohio spends, every check little by Ohio. So it's very interesting. And so basically the idea was Tony Blair who had this idea, said, let's put this information in the public domain and therefore, the citizens are going to supervise what the government does. So, Chow, which I mentioned here before, and I think it was Chow and Chi, wasn't it?
I think that was June.
Oh, June and Chow? Okay. So two of our PhD students, you're going to meet both of them because they're going to present something to you. June and Chow wrote a paper where they picked up contracts from the Brazilian government and tried to understand how they were spending their money. At first, the contracts were not there, just the data of the contracts, the data about the contracts. Second, turned out that June and Chow were very computer competent, and they had a lot of difficulty doing this. So what's happening is that when you publish this government data, you don't put all the data that should be there, no one inspects it, maybe you design it not to be very informational. There are a lot of stories happening this. But this is very, don't take it negative. This is extremely positive development. Because from one moment to the other, there is a lot of transparency that exists. And what I think is going to happen is what happened in industry too. You buy an application goes on top of the other one goes on top of them. And it's not really you, the armchair auditor, that's going to people that could analyze the data is the people that sell to the government, the people that buy from the government, their clients or their customers. Why? Because they want to figure out what the competition is, this and that, for example. And of course, those apps will be for sale. So That's a very good development. In the US, I think we'll be doing. So guys, how about we don't break this now that far apart?
And then we can lower it in the
future. We are starting. Okay, just want to go over the syllabus with you guys. If you're thinking about this class, as I said, it's not exactly what they do for class, etc. And you are going to do a lot of the teaching because we're going to have these two things I call this, and this two I call this a kind of project. And what this is going to be is you're going to be in groups and you're going to talk about the technology. If you go on the blackboard, you can already see some examples that are posted there. Okay? And I'm going to give you some leeway to the size of the topic because I'm going to give you some suggestions. But I'm going to give you some leeway. But you know, here is. I think this is a fun terminology. Like a presentation where like 3D printing, self-driving cars, the Great Wall of Electronic Wall of China. Everyone made some, and so that's the kind of projects. I'm going to want groups of three, not more than three. And you're going to make two presentations. One we call the issue, the other one will be the final presentation. So that's so they typically PowerPoints, and it's basically for teaching you technology, teaching you how to research technology, teaching you how to present things in groups in a cooperative manner. That is and you know, with all these new things that are evolving, maybe you'll come up with some new topics. I actually never have heard about 3D printing until a few years ago. You showed me 3D printing. Last year we had people 3D printing of organs. And of course, self-driving cars have a very big attention for them. But you know, you can do things like SQL, you can do analytic big data, how computers are changing your brain. There's many, many variations. And so I'm going to give you a schedule. Andrea will give you a schedule, and you kind of schedule your group there. And typically presentations are 20 minutes. During the semester, if a particular topic is terribly interesting, I don't cut it off. But in the final presentation day, I have to be honest about time because all will be here in the middle of the night. So we don't want to do that. So, and this is about 20% of the grade. The most important thing on the grade is class participation. As you notice, I create a dialogue and I won't stay with that. But there is a little tweak on this. Class participation also means finding interesting things on the internet and sharing with the class. Andrea will give you an email address to use, and you'll be getting 10, 20, 30 emails a day talking about different things in technology. Keep an eye on those because those things will be useful for you for the class, etc. If the volume gets too big, become a little bit selective about what you need. But I find those distribution lists extremely educational. I spend a lot of time reading because I learn by doing it. A lot of things that I teach you because I learn. I always say my classes are learning together. Because we're really learning a lot together. So don't forget, it's a very good way, in addition to talking in class, is talking in the mail, sending emails to class. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to now and then bring up some of the articles that we were about to talk about. And fantastic things like, did the Russians influence American elections? Or why did the Russians affect the French elections? Are very interesting things for us to discuss. Obviously, that's kind of past topic, and there are recurrent topics to be talked about, always there. About electronic cars, self-driving cars, it's tremendous things are happening within the next 3 years that will be commercially sold. At this moment in Pittsburgh, there are self-driving taxis, but laws require that there be a driver. So the driver sits over there and there is two big hands like a taxi. Same thing in Singapore going on at this moment. A couple of people, one person got killed in an accident of was the Apple car, was it? What's one of the
maybe
cars?
Google car.
Google car,
yeah.
Google car, yeah. And the question is not, will someone be hurt in a self-driving car accident? The question is, will self-driving cars be more dangerous than human-driving cars, where people get you? Okay, putting a higher standard for self-driving cars is ridiculous. I'm going to ask you, would you prefer to be in an airplane being landed by a person or by a self-driving pilot?
Well, my friend's a pilot and he was telling me that nowadays planes do basically land themselves and the pilot really just takes the facility for landing. So I wouldn't say it would make too much of a difference because there's so much of operating aircraft already done.
Yeah, I was next to a pilot of, I think it was American Airlines, sitting through a whole long flight, and he started talking about it. And he says that he doesn't really drive the plane most of the time, but he does take it over landing and takeoffs. And one of the reasons that he takes it over for a while is because that counts for the number of hours of flight that he's required to have to maintain the pilot license. So it's very, very interesting. But it's very interesting in your reaction here. You're very quiet about this thing. I asked this question 5 years ago. No one wanted to be on the self-landing plane. But you guys are pretty quiet. Any one of you have a strong reaction in favor or against? Who wouldn't be caught alive landing on that airplane? Who is against the idea of a machine landing? You?
Yeah.
How about the self-driving car? You also against it?
I'm not against it. I'd rather have a person.
You rather have a person. How about the self-driving car? Any one of you have a strong feeling about it?
No. Right now, most car accidents are actually caused by human error. Well, I think the statistic is like 80% of car accidents are actually caused by human error, and so that's why there's been this huge push for self-driving cars.
I don't think that's the driving force. I think that that's effective. I think that what's the driving force for self-driving cars?
Do other things. You can do other things.
That's right. It's comfort. By the way, it's very interesting. I actually want to talk about this for a second. It's very interesting to think about what's happening in the self-driving car arena. Because companies like Apple and Google are associating themselves with car manufacturers. Very interesting. Did you see the story of the Google guy who developed a lot of technology for Google, and then turned out that he got fired and left Google and went to Uber. And he took they claim there's a lawsuit going on that they took like 14,000 documents and basically sold it to Uber. So there's a big lawsuit, Uber just fired him back on the Medosta. And it's a very interesting story because very good attention is interesting. I read this in French magazine when I was waiting for them. But very interesting story that he was working for Uber. But at the same time, the company on the side and he was selling some things that the company developed to Google. So he was working for Google and selling to Google. And Google didn't seem to care until it became too much, where he left and took all his secrets to Google. A very, very interesting story, and it says, well, Google allows you to spend 30% of your time working on quote unquote creative projects, which is actually very dot com, very Silicon Valley, which is kind of open creativity. You go to web filings in Amos, Iowa, and they are a dot com kind of company. They have the people that, that invested on them, they put some money. Boppers, ex-chairman of the past, is one of the big investors there. Actually, the investors are on the board. But then you go over there, there are dogs in the campus, free food. You know, you go anytime during the day to the cafeteria there, and you have really expensive food. It's things that you would find in a restaurant, and this is great. I don't think it's that good to work at. People work like 18 hours a day. They are not told to, but they do, because that's not common. But back to the self-driving cars, they come from this type of culture. You can buy now a Mercedes-Benz huge truck that is self-driving. But it will only be self-driving. Designed for the German highways. And so it's good in Singapore, they have this thing driving itself. The Google car had millions of miles flying. They had, besides this fatal accident, they had two other earlier accidents. Both accidents, someone banged in the back. They were stopped in the red light, and someone hit them from the back. So what is your prognostic for this? What is your
prognostic? Well, I think the auto industry is working forward to implement autonomous car features into the cars, like peacefully. You see Toyota rolling out like lane change detection features into your Corolla.
I bought my car. My car is accurate. You know, I'm very happy. Highlander, I said, high tech. This girl, not man, but he offered a high tech car. So I bought, I finished up, I looked at all of the back, I looked at Lexus, and some ridiculous prices, Rovers, major technology, $80,000. But I've had a modest car because it had a lane change effect. And I felt, I'm always stuck tired. I was afraid I'd fall asleep and I lay there. I love it. It has kind of left and right detection. I've been for 4 years, so it's not 3 years, so it's not so new. The one feature I need, lane detection. Because you put that thing on, it's like beep, beep all the time. So the one thing I turn off on my car is the visual I want. Everything else is great. It's a very good car. And you know, this reminds me of Marvell Labs days. Marvell Labs days, we, for a while, I worked on a thing called the Consumer Lab. And the Consumer Laboratory was tested consumer features. And what the people that really know about consumers had to say, features sell, but no one uses them. So you buy a telephone because of all these fancy features, and then no one uses this features. Okay? So it was very interesting at that time. I will tell you some other stories about the consumer value eventually. But back to the self-driving car. I think the self-driving car is emblematic of what we are doing.
So I haven't, I don't know anything about self-driving.
So it's Nabil, not Nabil.
Nabil, yeah.
Okay,
yeah. So Nabil. I don't know anything, yeah. There you go. So I haven't been in self-driving cars, but I've flown self-flying aircraft. And so, from a consumer perspective, I think it's easy to be kind of scared by that kind of stuff. But commercially speaking, it does lighten the workload on the pilot's lot. So I know at least
for corporations and firms that need to move cargo or transport people or whatever, I think it's going to be very effective once people get over that initial fear of not having control.
And you like the point, because that was the point I was kind of driving to, is what, back to, I don't think the reason why that you described is the reason why people are going to self-driving. I think her reason is, I think what you said about convenience. Okay, no other things, it was Isabel. Convenience, but there are other reasons too. What are the other reasons?
Well, I know, I think it's probably along the Mercedes trucks and stuff, then you don't have to pay truckers to drive things back and forth across the country.
So the economics. There are this prediction, let me just check you on this thing. This prediction that once there are some driving cars out on the road, there'll be much less cars. Is that true? I'm wondering, I don't know if you know that, but I think the argument is that one car will service more people because your car usually is sitting 95% of the time. So, okay, that's one argument. But the other argument is, will I not have the car and just use Uber self-driving cars? So no, I think that's interesting. But what's going to motivate this? Is it, you think it's going to be a world with less accidents? I think there'll be a transition whereby a lot of humans and a few self-driving cars are going to crash. Eventually, first the technology is going to be better. The second thing is algorithms are going to be better. And let's just kind of put some words in the blackboard that I want you to keep in mind. Three things that has changed dramatically. Okay, and I'll come back to algorithms in a second. But the algorithms are going to progressively get better. And the complexities of the algorithms are going to be resolved. And keeping improving the algorithms. But the other two, cycle storage, and maybe we add here a little lower value. And I will talk about how it means in seconds. Let's just stay with this thought. So you have these cars driving around, okay, and with the passing of time, there'll be less cars driving by people, more cars driven by algorithms, by automobiles. Is that a reasonable assumption or not? Do you think people are going to stick with their Maseratis and not their Maseratis? Will people stick with their manual driven cars, or they're going to change to automatic?
I think like a lot of people will definitely change, but there are some people that just honestly like driving cars. That's probably why they get those high-end cars or fancy cars, because it's almost like their interest. And they like to learn how to drive either a manual car or just like the fashion statement of like driving around a nice car. So
I feel like that's
going to
become more of a hobby,
just
driving manual cars, and when you need to get from A to B,
we had a point before.
Well, I was going to say, I think it is reasonable to assume that it is the time to drive.
But actually, what you said, just to point to you, most, I think, original self-driving cars are going to be hand-drivable too. Okay, I think you'll have the option for you. You don't need to go to self-driving car that you cannot. I think eventually there'll be cars that will be like a couch. You would sit in the couch, have a nap, and just key in your address, like you key in your address in Waze. You key in your address, and the car will pick it up. And So that's, I think eventually that becomes a car, but that was the original. The first generation of self-driving cars going in the market, first they will be very expensive, okay? And they'll be, let's call it hybrid, but that's not the word, it's something self-driving and itself. I think the motivation is convenience. The most also is novelty. Some people like you love technology and you'll have it on. Meaning I would love to have a map on drivers. It's more of the better class or play with my dog, mochi. Did not allow the cameras. I don't know how unfair it is. But I got from a fake service dog bag. One of these things I will show up in the game and see. And the colors and stuff. Don't tell them that's a fake stuff. You know, I was on a plane coming back from Jackson Hole this January. There are six dogs in the airport, all with service dogs. Service dogs. And I said, well, you can buy them so they don't get you the URL and so on. I think that that's one of the that's why then there are several things about Wi-Fi. First is not really Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi is a local device, but they are telecommunication interfaces typically to wireless telephone lines or geo. Use that, but the particular interconnectivity to the car is a very dangerous thing. It's the privacy, it's the safety. I mean, you probably saw last year this guy on what was the car? It was it Ford Explorer, isn't it? That he hacked into the Ford Explorer and took over the command of the car. But of course, he was an employee of Ford Explorer. But of course, that book. Remember, technology given, technology. You have a self-driving car that some guy can, you know, some spy can kidnap you, taking control of your car. There'll be films about that very soon. I'll tell my doctor. But technology given, technology, can we just speculate a little bit more about the self-driving car? It's going to be, when is it going to be out that you can sell by? Supposing you have $100,000, not $50,000. Tesla's are very fast in that. The rumor is they had it out 3 years, 2.5 years. But when are they going to be out? 2.5 years, is that it? Actually, there was an article on McKinsey magazine. McKinsey. And they said, don't anticipate them to come out so soon. But I don't understand that argument, because we have taxis running at this moment and are self-learning. But you know, one of the big obstacles is not the technology, it's the legislation. You know, for example, why Pittsburgh? Because of Carnegie Mellon University. Carnegie Mellon University has advanced informatics, cybernetic laboratory. Intelligence, they have it there. The other thing to think about is that I've said this for a reason. Typically do that. The other thing to observe in this is that these cars are a series of autonomous technologies. They have LiDAR, they have radar, or whatever they have. They have cameras to the back, they have all kinds of technologies. For different purposes. And one of the big challenges is making those technologies work together. Now, have you ever thought about your body? How does it work? It's also a set of autonomous technologies that your brain is communicated to and interferes when needed. But if your brain needed to every second be controlling everything that you do, like your brain, your breathing, your walking, etc.
set would be more difficult. And, but it depends if your leg would swell, and your ear would swell, and your eyes would swell. And when one doesn't work well, what happens? You fall into a hole, or your brain reforms and takes hold and starts reorganizing in order to be able to deal with that deficiency. You know, it's kind of well known that black people hear that, things like that. But do we learn something about that for this, about this self-driving car? Can you learn something from that? The fact that your brain controls, but it doesn't take care of everything at the same time? Give it a shot. Just offend the audience. Don't be ashamed. Correct. You have all these autonomous systems, one looking to the right, other one looking to the left, the third one looking to the front, the fourth one, whatever, directing where you go. And when the one detecting in the right detects that there is some dangerous movement in the left, it communicates to the central unit. And this integration is very difficult. That's probably a very serious topic. I want to change topics. I'm not changing topic, but then changing topic. How many of you have used the Waze everywhere, correct? And if you haven't used the Waze, you use Google Maps. Okay, now.
Did Google purchase Waze?
Yes, Google purchased Waze, but Waze is still better than Google Maps.
But
Google owns Waze. Waze was developed by an Israeli company, which had 7 employees and sold Waze for about $1.2 billion. And it was one of the best acquisitions of Google. When your stock is selling at $800, you can buy many companies for no cost. Okay, now, just pushing on you a little bit. Tell me about Waze. What does Waze do? Yeah.
It creates a community that share traffic, accidents, lanes. That's something that Google Maps doesn't have, but didn't have at the moment. So it's communicating to people. It's a 20-mile interview, and if there's an accident, I just tap it in and I'll let you know, so you can reroute 100 passengers avoiding that accident.
Okay, you started in a place that didn't expect you to start, but you said a little bit. What is the basic purpose of Waze? What's the purpose of it? Why do you turn the Waze on?
Get directions.
More than that. Yeah, directions. That's right. I heard in direction. You turn the Waze on to get you from point A to point B. And go ahead.
You get road alerts while you're driving.
Yeah, and why do you turn on Waze, not Google Maps? Response time is faster?
No, that's supposed to be able to get you around traffic so you
Yes, and how does it do that? How does it do that?
Across the community involvement.
It's called group sourcing. Group sourcing is when you get third parties to cooperate with something. Okay, and the big difference originally, now it's not there anymore, or is there less? Was that Google Maps had maps, and this thing had information. And how do they get that information? By other people. If no one is driving using Waze, Waze is not very better than the old Google Maps. But the moment there are 50,000 people driving in New York City, you know every road of the more transited roads, how fast it moves. Are we all in sync here of that? Do you all understand that? Okay, let's now pull another thing. what does it have there? It has a map, okay? Exactly as Google Map has. And we call that the middle world. What is a middle world? Middle world is an other world that has a representation of the real world. Okay, do you understand why it's a middle world? It's, you are here, and there is a state up here that has a map of heaven. And it connects the middle world and the real world connect to your device. Are we done with that? No, we're not done with that. Okay. Now, the moment you say, I want to go to Rutgers, one Washington Plaza. And it goes again. Andrea, salvage me here. But it's my fault this time. I wasn't feeling good. But let's talk to the guys. Don't have any knowledge. So what else happens? There is this map. You communicate it with it. Now it has to decide between here and here how to go there. How does it do that? To an algorithm. Now that's where we start thinking about algorithms and start thinking what they can do. Okay. What can this algorithm do? Well, there are many, many approaches of what you can do. If you had to design this algorithm, how would you start? Yeah.
Short distance by miles and closed roads, give us instructions.
Good. One more thing you forgot is roads have directionality. Like you can go this way, you can go that way. So there is a directionality. So what you would try to do is a straight line between the two of them, figure out how to get there. Okay, that would be just a turn left, turn right, open. Yes? Now, can you please add complexity to this algorithm to make it a little better? Come on, guys, this is the way to design algorithms. Come on.
Traffic patterns.
Okay, you're getting very fancy. Let's go to traffic patterns next. Yeah.
Speed limit.
Okay, speed limit. So you have an algorithm that now says, this is faster speed limit, the faster set up the algorithm that we decide to choose the fastest. If that too. But there are more than that. What else do you think about this? This is a, if it is very close, there is only one path. But in reality, the combinatorics, the things that you can do to get to some place, usually is very large. So it has to choose which one it's going to look to find out a way to go. And there are many alternatives. So you notice in many of these map devices, you have, you prefer highways or you prefer local streets. And Waze asks you, or even Google Map gives you alternatives that you can choose. And now Waze gives you how long it will take. Yes or no? And why would you choose a longer distance as opposed to a longer time as opposed to a shorter?
Roads.
Oh, you want to save money.
Yeah.
Good, 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 good. That's an algorithm. So you could put that in the in your parameters and say avoid tolls. Okay? Or you prefer highways and et cetera, et cetera. What else is to be considered in this? If the algorithm is going to take just the next turn or the next 10 turns, or is going to look at the whole thing and decide each time what's the best route. Correct? There are many ways to think about this particular problem. Now, add to your algorithm, if you have a lot of cycles, cycles mean fast computers that do a lot of things for you. Okay, if you have a lot of cycles, what are you going to do?
Keep refreshing.
direction would root.
Right, that's exactly the point. You are going to do a frequent refresher because you have a lot of cycles to do that. Now, let's get fancy and follow your example. Now we know the traffic. We are constantly getting traffic feeds. So what changes in your algorithm?
Avoiding traffic.
A little bit louder.
Avoiding traffic.
Avoiding traffic. Okay, so how was algorithm we are going to use? Least time, design some paths and see the least time.
You do that, or depending on the user, you might even have some kind of problem, you could just turn
least
off.
Least time, but use highways. Least time, but go to the beach to look at the bikinis, or whatever. Okay. No, it's a objective function that you're defined. Now we go to this other thing. Yes, every time I leave here and go home and looking at Waze, it tells me it's going to take 45 minutes. By the time I'm there, it takes an hour. Why is that? Because I leave here when the rush traffic is just starting. And those streets are still not very busy. And by the time I'm 10 minutes from here, the traffic became much busier. And they keep changing my time to later. And if I would be much later, you would have the opposite effect. You start decreasing the time to get there. Now, your algorithm, and this is just to talk about the algorithm, you could use storage to resolve this problem. How would you do that? You would record historically what is the traffic on this street at certain times, what traffic on that street at certain time, and make a prediction. Would you be right? No. But do you hope that you're not very wrong? Now do you understand what I'm just talking about algorithms? Let me just say another thing that we're going to come back to. This whole idea of algorithms and mathematical algorithms is a very interesting idea. But the basic algorithms on machine learning have been around for 20 years or 30 years. What really changed that we are hearing all these artificial intelligence devices, what's really changed is that now you can pull much more cycles and much more storage of it, and you can get much more information than you. The thing you're going to see, Sophia is going to come and talk to you, things I'm talking about applying artificial intelligence to auditing. And she's doing a dissertation on a technology called deep learning. Deep learning is actually neural networks, ANN technology, on steroids. What does that mean? That they picked up the ANN technology and instead of learning one hidden layer, they learn 10 hidden layers into a lot of cycles. So they keep trying until they get the result better. And every time it gets a little better, say, this is the baseline, let's try it, let's try it, let's try it. And so sometimes deep learning algorithms have a million interactions, or a billion interactions. Within 2 or 3 years, you're going to pick up your cell phone, take a picture of your skin as a diagnostic to skin cancer. Okay, and there are devices already out there doing that. How did they develop the deep learning algorithm and the parameters for that? They developed it by getting thousands and thousands of cases they had that doctors had diagnosed cancer on your skin and the evidence that they had to decide that. And even if some of those doctors were wrong, overall the thing was better. And so then this deep neural network keep going interacting, improving the results of the algorithm until the parameters the best they could find or they thought was good enough. So now they have that formula. And what does the application do when they take a picture of your skin? The application collects the evidence that they need. They put it on the formula and they give evidence. Are you uncomfortable with the device giving you a diagnostic of skin cancer?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I like that. This is a, are you, Fatima? Are you uncomfortable with that? No?
Yeah.
You are, yeah. I think it's very meaning. I had this in, I always talk about the airplane landing, you a machine doing the diagnostic, and etc. And usually the story is 1 year, many students are very comfortable, like self-driving car was a horrendous thing 10 years ago, and now most people think, oh yeah, that's not such a bad idea. And I think diagnostics is the kind of thing. Meaning I actually feel better with the machine diagnostic to me because it's based on many, many people as opposed to one. But this is just a question of progressive acceptance of technology. But that's the reason I put this whole story here, is what we have today is usually the same algorithms, although just recently they developed a new algorithm for deep learning that cuts the heaviness of the algorithm substantially, makes it easier to compute. And then you basically add a lot of computing power, considering that your cell phones and other computer devices are much more powerful, added a lot of ability of storage. And when people ask me, when we talk about singularity here, and what is a singularity? Is the time computers are going to be smarter than people. Have you ever heard this discussion? And you know, you look at film talking about how taking over the spaceship and et cetera, et cetera. You know, computers are already smarter than people. Can you multiply 10 digits by 10 digits in 1/10 of a second? Or a minute of a second? Can you retrieve from a list of 1 million mails the right name in a nanosecond? No. So computers can do deterministic functions reasonably much better than you. When it becomes more complicated is when you put these different components together. And one thing I didn't say, on top of all of this, there is this thing that I was talking about, the body, a controlling mechanism, operating, the best way I can call it is an operating system. And those things, you have to progressively improve. And the brain, the human being, has the capacity of reorganizing. If you have a small stroke in your head, the brain will be able to reorganize some of the functions. Or it has to be a big damage or a very crucial point that the brain cannot deal with. And we are going to talk more about this. Okay, let's go back to the symbols. The reason I was talking about this is because this discussion will permeate the course. Okay, so class participation 40%, these two presentations. Now the final exam is going to be from home. Open the internet, open everything except facts. You do it by yourself. And it's going to be about something that we did not cover in class. It's going to be something you're going to have to learn while you're doing it. So I always feel it's a privilege to have 3 hours of your time and make you learn something. However, the thinking that goes into it is like, rational thinking, etc., etc. And I don't think you should be particularly worried about the final exam. Where makes your grade, although I don't like to motivate the class with grades, I like the class being interesting, is class participation. Okay, and now and then I might do something like ask you to, I'm going to ask you every class to read something. You have the reading on the syllabus, but I might change that. Yeah, there is a lot of readings that change. Okay, and I'm going to every week send you a little email. Actually, Andrea will send you a little email saying, read this, this, and this. Okay, that doesn't mean you don't need to read other things, but it means that those things you need to cover. And now and then, I might give you a little quiz. Usually, talk about what the argument is at ABC. You're going to say, explain me this thinking or something like interpretive type of thing. In order to answer it, you can open your computer and look at the computer. Okay. So I am not into memorization. Okay, now, in general, the classes we have the structure, some readings, and then there'll be an issue. And in the beginning, I'm going to cover the issues. Later on, each one of you group is going to make a presentation. And typically, there are less presentations in the beginning, more presentations at the end. There are about 35 people in this class, so there'll be, let's say, 36. There will be 12 groups, and each one make a 20-minute presentation or something like that. Okay. Everyone needs to talk on the presentation. Can't be, she does the work for one project, she does the work for other project. I want you to learn how to talk and discuss a technical issue. Okay. And so that's basically the structure. And now let's just see a little bit what we are going to cover. Today we just a little introduction. I actually was planning to show you a presentation that will leave a little bit kind of a loss. It's a presentation I just made to the our we call the RADAR Advisory Board. The RADAR is a Rutgers AICTA Data Analytics Research Initiative. And this is a project unique for any university or company that 8 CPA firms, the Big Four plus the next Big Four, support AICTA and the Canadian doing analytics. Okay. And in that project, in that presentation, I will show a couple of the things that we are doing and show you a little bit about how the structure of audit works. I'll do that next time, first thing. Okay? But that one. Also, I asked Denise to speak about drones, but Denise is not going to come on the 12th, she's going to come on the 26th because she has a conference. And I'm going to ask you to talk, set up a group. Okay, just find two other people to work with you. And think about what you could do for a project. And Andrea is going to remind me, and I'm going to send you a whole list of issues, which I hope you do something different. Okay, meaning a little bit of creativity is good. But talking about self-driving cars, we're talking about analytics and audit, we're talking about 3D printing, we're talking about artificial organs, we're talking about Uber, we're talking about Airbnb. It's fine, it's actually interesting. And most of you find presentation very interesting, meaning it's not something that is very painful. And I'm going to talk a little bit about backups next time just to make sure we don't have any accidents. Every class I teach, there is someone that loses everything. So let's talk about not happening that kind of thing. And I have this presentation that I use very often about predicting technology, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that. I already gave you some seeds about that. And this thing on big data, this is an academic article that we wrote here. We're actually just in the process of retaking it. But I'm going to talk a little bit about that article, but not too much because we have a lot next class. Okay, and then talk about the reasons of the economy, et cetera, et cetera. And I wanted to talk to you about the new education. As today I didn't have time, we're going to get to how to put technology into education. And we are in the business school, in the accounting department, have a whole set of initiatives of this type. Editing about what we call SWAM, which SWAM stands for School of a Million Courses, or School with a Million Courses. And what that is our audit analytics. This analytic curriculum atomized into little modules, and the student can choose which module they will take with the help of the faculty. And you guys, if you take an auditory class in general, you are going to have a little module like that, that you'll be able to choose what you take. Okay, that's one thing. Today, you probably noticed there was a lady standing over there, and there was a little camera here. Okay, and that little camera is a visual reality camera. And basically what that allows you to do is to create a film which is virtual reality. So what we are trying to do as an educational experiment is give a part or a situation. situation at home that you can be sitting over there and participate in the class if you're virtually participating. Okay, but we actually, there are really two modes of that. One mode is participating from there, the other mode is just putting your earphones on or whatever the device you have, Oculus, you know, Zen just came by it because he bought the Oculus. And attending the class as you are here, but you're not participating, you're just attending. The dean asked me to talk to the different departments to start a whole set of these experiments. Let's see if they have the pace for it. We are not doing another meeting. What I want to talk to you is to think about how education is going to be and how can we make it better. In this class, I'm going to rebalance this a little bit about the less real-time economy, and we'll talk more about artificial intelligence. I published a series of 6 books from the late 80s to early 90s about artificial intelligence and accounting model. And at that time, the firms had invested money on basic expert systems. Nothing happened out of it. Now I think it's really going to happen. Andrea, let's put the Davenport article on the list, take something out. Davenport, the quickie number. This article, this guy from Davenport, you're going to hear about him again later, you can read them a little, but Davenport surveyed the Big Four, and at least I personally have seen talk to people on the 3 of the Big Four doing big data projects that leading to artificial intelligence. PwC has developed a tool inside, and they are basically looking at contracts. KPMG has applied Watson and is looking at assessing loan defaults in banks. And Deloitte is doing a project, as far as I know, on leases, on contracts. AI is certainly not related up to this technology. Maybe follow up on my skin cancer example, etc., and talk a lot about how can you do this AI stuff, and we haven't played a little bit with the idea of the singularity and what that means. And in this section here, okay, there's 2 sections. Just talking about this one, I think I went wrong. I had a little bit about employment, robots, and unemployment. Okay, and it's not unemployment of auditors, although we already mentioned that, it's about replacing human beings from replacing machines for human beings, or replacing human beings for machines. And does it sound horrendous? As far as it's not me, it's okay, right? It's just like a self-driving car, right? If it has great convenience, it's worth doing. Now, I just want to call your attention, we're going to come back to this, but this has happened several times before. Okay, industrialization in the UK, okay, and then industrialization of farms in the United States, where 30-something% of the population became 5% population working farms. And then the US had about 30-40% of people working in industry. Now it's less than 10%. So typically society readapts on these things, and we are close to full employment at this point, which I can say many years ago, 8 years ago. So it's an interesting talk, and they talk a little bit about the age of re-education, where in your lifetime careers you are 4 different things or 5 different things, and your generation is a generation of people that don't stay on a job. I actually think that accountants, like auditors, tend to stay on jobs, but I don't have any evidence to If Andre is an example, it's not who. Well, 3-4 years on the payment. My wife is the worst example. My wife retired this year. And please don't show her my pay. And by the way, this is a rule for this force. Never tell my kids or my wife what I say about them. And no, my dog, please don't tell me what I say about them. My wife has been in like 8 universities or 10 universities as CFO, head of internal audit. She was head of internal audit of she was CFO of Columbia Medical. She keeps like changing jobs. And you know, the correlation has got Ed Schein from MIT Jones School with the study. This was my professor when I went there. The only thing he found during the 30-year longitudinal study of Sloan School MBA graduates is the only covariate that explained success in terms of financial success was how often you change your jobs. The more you change your job, the more money you make. Fortunately, my wife was involved. The thing was, she was MBA to be the more. It's strange, isn't it, this whole idea of more you change your job, more money you make. But however, I say something about CPA firms. First 6 years you stay at a CPA firm, your salary doubles. If you stay 6 more years, it doubles again. So that's pretty good. That's pretty good. However, the staffing is not that compared with other things. Of course, we professors argue for that. And then this is actually very interesting, and I already introduced you a little bit. It's this idea that now that we have technology, particularly cell phones, you can concentrate better. And you think in a different ways. And actually, we're going to talk a little bit about that, and I think we're going to talk a little bit about how to apply the phones. We're going to talk a little bit about XBRL. My friend, the professor Paulo Caetano, visiting from Brazil, volunteered to teach this. I'm going to think about that. And I'm going to have June Day come here and talk to you about Audit 4.0 and about a little bit about blockchain. But she's going to come probably next week because she's moving back to China. That's hopefully Dr. June Day very soon. So I'm going to get her while she's around here. The dissertation very visionary. Okay. Then I am planning to talk to you about the area that we are experts on, which is this continuous audit, continuous monitoring. My research center, our research center here, is called the CALA, Continuous Auditing and Reporting Laboratory. It has been around for around 15 years, but I have been doing this continuous auditing research since I was in Bell Labs, so it has been a long time. And yes.
Can we use DSI to do a continuous auditing?
Do what?
Use DSI. Yeah, I see that you have DSI on your computer. You have DSI A-Y-A-S.
I don't understand how you can use auditing with that.
Can you use that tool, that software to continue?
We actually don't have a software, do we?
Mm-hmm.
I don't think so. We don't have a software. What we have a RAW, Rutgers Accounting Web, which is a very deep website with a lot of conferences and examples. But we have that tool, we have tools we use yearly basically, such as like SPSS, SAS, R, ICON, okay, in the different projects. But we haven't developed a continuous auditing tool. However, both ACL and IDEA, Caseware IDEA, have some tools that do some of the things that we want them to do. And we will talk about it. Okay? I don't know, maybe it actually is something we should have done, develop the tool, but I'm never in the business of development. I'm always in the help of developing papers. We like it. But no, we haven't done that. Although now companies are doing some of it. Okay. So So we're going to talk about continuous audit, and then we are going to spend some time talking about different methods of analytics. Hopefully we're going to develop talk about some of the radar projects here, and I'm going to have a couple of our PhD students come in and tell them that they are doing. By the way, PA, Dr. Denise Applebaum just finished her dissertation 2 weeks ago, and she was a PA student. Dr. Huidu graduated 15 years ago, she was a PA student. Every couple of years, I have a PA student that comes into the PhD program. And all of us, my students, become professors, they don't become practitioners. Yes. My PhD student, not my master. Yes.
Do we have to take the GRE to the
PhD? You have to take either the GMAT or the GRE.
You can't accept this GRE.
I have no authority for that. But she can tell you everything about the PhD program, and you're going to be having chance to talk with Denise. Denise is a very unusual person. Denise was the world record holder of free weight lifting. She's a strong lady. Now, although she looks kind of skinny now, because they have tremendous control on what she does with her body. But you'll see, she's don't fool around with her, she's strong. She was in this class, actually, when I had that time, I taught the two classes, I taught but I know I had to have the two classes, and as Joe did, we actually did it. Okay, we don't have a lot of scholarships, but we did find this scholarship. What's great. Professor Huidu, she's at the University of Houston, she very, very published. She'll be the co-editor of JPN and CA with me. Now I'm editor, now she'll be the co-editor. She's also a PhD. You know, there's kind of, I talked with Hui. Hui started, I was teaching this class, so maybe all of it was. And comes to the midterm, I told you the midterm at that time, and she gets like 97 and everyone gets, the best grade was 8. Okay, comes to the final, same kind of thing. If I go to Hui and say, Hui, even if she ran the PhD program, I'm too dumb for that, another day. Okay. Chinese lady, very, very simple. You know, and then about a year later, just when she was going to finish, and I wanted to join the PhD, just off of the blue sky. I had no idea what she did, and she was a great PhD student. And at that time, I couldn't find a scholarship, so she had a scholarship. Okay, now, so we are going to cover this computer analytics. And we are going to read this article by Davenport, Computing on Analytics. And if you see those examples, example Uber example, I left some examples there of what Susan presented. I try to, when you present, or when you suggest a topic, I will ask them the way to do, try to match with the topic, but it's not needed. Okay? But Davenport talks about how analytics can make a business better, and the other is very interesting. And then we are going to finish up with a big discussion. Actually, we are not going to finish up. We are going to talk about cyberspying, influencing elections, and AICPA new proposed guidelines on cybersecurity. Actually, today we had one of our PhDs, not actually my student, but I was his chairman, talking about cybersecurity and studies in cybersecurity. So we are very interested in that. And we are going to try to talk a little bit about NSA, Chelsea Manning, et cetera, and see what the issues are. Meaning, I'm not very political, so don't worry that I will be trying to indoctrinate to get Gates, President Trump, or in favor of President Trump, etc. I'm much more interested in the technology around it. And the same thing with cybersecurity. We are going to talk a little bit about what happened in the WikiLeaks papers, et cetera, and how it was attacked. Also, we're going to try to talk a little bit about the WannaCry bug that just hit everything. Okay? And just what I want you to do is to kind of become very conscious. I think that there is a very high chance that the auditor job we have a cybersecurity component. And all of the firms say, well, we have our specialists in cybersecurity. I think every audit will have to consider cybersecurity, and in certain cases, do the same thing they do with auditing, they do with IT audit, they will have to consult the specialists. But there'll be the manager of the job, the person deciding on the step-by-step of the audit, will have to make a series of educated decisions. Okay. And then I hope that we talk about blockchain and smart contracts. You must have heard about Bitcoin. There is an epidemic of talking about blockchain. The epidemic is, there are about, I heard, I don't know if this is true, but there are about 600 companies trying to do ventures in blockchain. And one of the companies called Libra has contacted us, and we are kind of talking about making agreement with them of putting a prototype together with them to experiment. And we have one of our PhD students that already did put a little prototype together and also use that as one part of his dissertation. But we are going to talk about blockchain as a way to store accounting records, and also blockchain as a using it for auditing. And I'm probably going to ask Andrea to talk a little bit about it, because she's interested and she has written a paper on that, mainly about, I would like her to talk about smart contracts, and I would like maybe Yusuf to talk about the infrastructure of blockchain. And by the way, you need to learn this. Blockchain is going to, I think it's going to be real big. It's just a question of where and how. Many companies like Goldman Sachs, Goldman Stanley, etc. are implementing blockchain as we talk. And all the, and at least two of the firms I know are spending a lot of money in blockchain for the city. Okay. And if we have time at all, we are going to talk about startups and etc. If I don't get there, I might put one here in the final example. Okay. And this day, and I'm going to ask you to change the time. I think in your schedule is in the morning. I'm going to have a visit in the afternoon, because I'm flying in at 5:30 in the morning, so I don't want to be late for the presentations. You're going to make your presentation, final presentation, and then a little bit later, we have the exam. And I think that's, those are the dates. But the professors and I will be interested. And we are 5:10, and so for me to start with something else, then maybe you guys want to go on. But we don't do this very often. Don't get used to it. Okay? It's long. You know why the classes are longer in this class? Because this is not a regular semester, it's a short semester. So we have to do certain four hours. Okay, and I'm very good with email. I tend to respond my email visibly fast, only when I have mail or something or in class. Andrea, you have her address in the syllabus. The syllabus has been posted. I will change the syllabus. Hey, by the way, that syllabus is not like your schedule. That's immutable. Depending on how the class goes, I'm going to include the syllabus, what I think is the best thing for you. Okay? As I told you, it's the creation of trying to improve our people. I'm going to try to know a lot of people's names, and try to put the names in front of me so I get to know them better. Okay? Oh, one more thing. Very important thing. Don't let things go by without understanding. Stop. It's never an embarrassment to stop. Embarrassment is an hour later, I ask you a question, I have no idea what I'm talking about. Yes. You don't have any idea what I'm talking about?
No. I have a question. I went into your syllabus, you said that you would be using clippers for participation, but I couldn't find the turning technology add-on platform.
Good, you can find that out. And I actually need a clipper too, and I haven't got one. So I'm going to get the clipper for next Monday. And Professor Andrea Rosario is going to explain all of us how to use clippers. Correct? And we definitely will use clippers, and I'm going to do And I think you will use the clickers also in your presentation. Forget the good part of this. I like clickers. I use clickers for 10 years. I just don't like so much clickers. You are too fancy, like this. We will use your clickers.
As a follow-up.
Huh? Follow-up.
So do we only need to register a clicker and connect to the black hole once or one time?
Don't worry, Andrea will tell you what.
Yeah, I have to talk to Professor Chanel about that.
We haven't got a clicker yet, that's why. Because he didn't give me a clicker, I didn't think you guys had a clicker. I think the first question I did, first couple of students came here, do you guys got clickers? I love clickers.